Good evening. Welcome back to The Bible Speaks Today from LBC Television Ministries. We are on chapter 8 or part 8 or the 8th program, which I hope, if I can get through the script quick enough, will be the last one on Jerusalem. I don't want to rush through it and spoil some of the information for you. And at the end of the program, I'll let you know what we're doing next. How's that? We do actually know what we're doing next, which is an absolute miracle for us, because most of the time it's like, I don't know, what should we do next? And you'll forgive me if I use my little electronic notepad here, but it's a lot easier than turning over to here and trying to look at paperwork. If you watch this program on a regular basis, don't be afraid to let us know. The easiest way to do that, of course, is to email. My email comes up in a minute, and you can email me and say, I watch your program and think it's terrible, or I watch your program and I'm interested, or whatever. It would be nice to have a dialogue with people who watch it on a regular basis and who might come up with a suggestion for something. One of the hardest things to do when you've been doing this program 12, 15 years is coming up with something new. I don't mean that the Bible gets stale or it runs out of things, but, you know, there are a lot of things in there you could do and talk about, but would have an interest value to only about X percent of the population. And obviously we want to appeal to as great a many as people. And for those of you who watch on television, and they do put a crawl up or something, I'm not supposed to look at the monitor, by the way, which is over here, so I'm looking at you. But they do put a crawl up on the monitor, which gives you the church website. And on the website, last time I looked, there's a whole host of Bible Speak programs up to date, you know, the ones we've just done, or some of the older ones. So you can, if you get, you know, I think I'd like some Bible information today, well, there's a good place to go. I mean, Lord knows there's enough information out there on the worldwide net for Bible study and churches and Sunday schools and things like that, and correspondence and that. But there aren't too many programs like this, which is a locally based detailed discussion of what the Bible says today, or what happens in the Bible, or the things, the places and the people in the Bible. Not everybody's going to get a chance to go to Jerusalem. In fact, minority rather than the majority. I mean, even if the world becomes a much traveled place and we have pneumatic tubes that swish under the ocean and get us from place to place, you know, we're still not all going to be able to afford to go to Jerusalem or any other place in the Holy Land. And it is today the center point of a great deal of the world tensions, really. I mean, there are other places, but the Holy Land, the Middle East, was and probably will be for the foreseeable future a hotbed of religious differences, religious tolerances, religious wars, if you like. Everybody believes that they're right, and you can argue till you're blue in the face, I suppose, about your particular point of view or anything. And if somebody doesn't want to believe it, then they're not going to. Maybe the good Lord has a plan for us all after. Well, I know he's got a plan for us, but I mean, sometimes, you know, I sometimes feel like saying, what about now? Wouldn't now be a good time? You know, but then again, his time, not ours. As I finished up last week, I was saying that when Allenby took over Jerusalem in 1917, General Allenby, it was a patchwork of networks of communities and things, and they left it alone. This is new, okay. And under British rule, the new Jerusalem continued to be bigger outside the city walls for much the same reason as it did in the middle of the 1800s. People wanting to live in Jerusalem. Hey, you know, it's where it all happens. After the First World War and the Second World War, there was a tremendous influx of people. I mean, we'll talk about the Second World War in a minute, but there was a tremendous, people wanted to live there. It was the place to go. I mean, oranges growing on the trees, you know, beautiful climate, and Jesus, what else could you hope for? You know, I mean, it's a great place to be. So what happened was that, as so often happens, the new city grew and flourished and became big, and the old city inside the walls became, you know, an older, impoverished neighborhood. At least one of the things the British did, and I didn't know this, I found this out in my research. One of the things the British did was a town planning order. I guess we're good at that sort of thing, you know. Anyway, they required all the buildings in the city to be faced, not built, but faced with sandstone. In other words, you could build them anything you want to, you know, plastic, brick, whatever, but the facing of them, you know, the outside walls, had to be finished with sandstone, which was the old building material of Jerusalem since day one. Sandstone's very plentiful there. And so they tried to keep the place looking like it was. They didn't try and, you know, urban blight where they put up skyscrapers and that. You can't do that in Jerusalem. You can't, literally. Okay? There are some cities in, I remember a city I lived in Mexico when I was working there for a few years, called Querétaro. It had cobbled stones on the major roads in the center of the city. You know, cobbles, about so big around, you know, 4-inch square cobbles. And a plethora of wires hanging everywhere from building to building, you know, telephone and television and all that good stuff. And they made an effort. They took all the wires down, all of them, and put them underground. And then within a, I won't say a square mile, probably less than that, but within the older city bounds, which had about 15 churches in it, they resurfaced all the roads with cobbles, left it. So when you go there today, some of the buildings are more modern, but like a lot of buildings in older cities, they stay the same. It looks like 17th and 18th century Spanish Mexico. It really is quite amazing. And this is what the British did in Jerusalem. So even though it grew, it didn't look different. It wasn't, you know, you couldn't say, well, that's 10 years ago and that's today because the buildings are different. They were all the same, okay? And in the 30s, there was these two big institutions were built. One is the Hadassah Medical Center, which is still going today. It's a huge big medical center. And the Hebrew University. Now, these were major construction in Jerusalem. And the university was on Mount Scopus, which is outside the main city. And the Hebrew University today is one of the most prestigious universities in the Middle East. And it's where a lot of the Bible studies and old Dead Sea Scrolls studies go on, okay? The problem is that the British rule did what all outside rules do. They create unrest. People don't want to be governed by somebody outside. Okay, so you won the war. Thanks a lot. Get out. I mean, that's really what it was all about. I imagine, of course, if you watch the movies or read the books like Revolt in the Desert or Lawrence's other book, I forget the name of it now, Pillars of Wisdom. If you read those, you will find that it looks like the British promised the Arabs home rule over the areas after the war for their help, which is the usual thing you do, and then realised that if they did, they might not have control of the oil, so they stayed on. And, of course, it started a lot of unrest. And there was a lot of Arab resentment about the British rule and also a huge influx, as I said, of Jewish immigrants. After the war, it seemed to be the in thing for Jews to immigrate to Palestine. I mean, we're jumping ahead a minute for a second, but in 1948, I read that 1 in 6 Jews in Palestine, a whole country, lived in Jerusalem. Not the old city, but in the main city. So everybody, you know, there were people outside, but 1 in 6, that's a huge number of the population. Anyway, but the resentment we had with these this British rule, what it did was it boiled over into anti-Jewish riots. So the Arabs getting mad at the Jews in 1920, 1929, and on into the 30s, that caused, like riots do, a lot of damage and several deaths. So what happens? The Arabs attach the Jews organize self-defense forces. You know, there was a big, in 1920, there was a big Arab revolt, which did kill a large number of Jews. So the Jews, you know, we've had enough of this, formed their own defence force. And what happens now is that the Jews start bombing the British and doing terrorist attacks against the British because they suspect that the British are in cahoots with the Arabs, again, because of the oil problem. The Brits are trying to keep the Arabs happy, so in Jerusalem, or in Israel, they're siding with the Arabs. I don't know that that's necessarily true, but what happened to make it worse was, in 1939, just before the Second World War, the British restricted immigration. So just before World War II, the British restricted anyone immigrating, any Jews immigrating into Palestine. Now you can imagine, I mean, we've got off the numbers a bit here, but Germany is persecuting the Jews, right? All the European powers knew it, wasn't a secret. America knew it. Everybody, most every government knew about the concentration camps long before they became public knowledge. The Jews are being persecuted. They're trying to escape to somewhere. Nobody will take them. The Brits don't want them. The Swiss don't want them. The Italians don't want them. Well, they were in the war with Germany anyway. And they can't go to Israel because there's an immigration ban. So you can see the situation, okay? And in 1946, the war finished. Okay, the Allies were victorious. What happens? Nothing changes as far as Israel's concerned. In 1946, those of us who are old enough to remember, a Zionist group called the Irgun, now you'll read all sorts of novels about this group, and there's a couple of movies based, you know, biased one way or the other. But what they did was they blew up, literally blew up the King David Hotel, which is a huge hotel in downtown Jerusalem, okay, in the modern downtown. And this is where the British forces had their headquarters, you know, their officers and their brigadiers and everything. And it was huge. It led to the death of a huge amount of civilians. Okay. At that point, the British government, I think, thought this is pointless. What's the point in staying? So the British decided to go. Okay? They partitioned the country between Jordan and Israel. And of course, you know, the fight starts. And the fight for Jerusalem, obviously whoever controls Jerusalem is basically in charge, so the fight for Jerusalem starts. You know, there were huge casualties amongst both the fighters, the British, the Jewish, the Arab sides. Okay? And by 1948, which is when the British withdrew completely, and with the British forces obviously reluctant to intervene, you know, because they didn't want to get killed, they want to get out with a clean, you know, like you do when you're trying to get out of the country. The roads to Jerusalem were cut off by Arab, you know, groups, Arab armed groups, which obviously put the Jerusalem in a state of siege, put the Jewish population under siege. Not something that hadn't happened before, if you've been following this program, happened quite a lot. Okay. By this time, of course, the city is in the middle of New Jerusalem. We're talking about the whole city. And eventually, I don't want to go too much history because you can go to the library and get that. But the siege was broken, although there were massacres, literally massacres of civilians on both sides. The Israelis or the Jews fought just as mean and dirty as the Arabs did. And when you're fighting for survival, I suppose that's what you do. Okay. And this was before the 1948 Arab-based war began with the end. As soon as the British Mandate finished in May 48, the Arabs attacked. Okay? What it did do, it led to massive displacements of everybody. Jews were pushed out of their places, Arabs were pushed out of their places, you know, and it was mobs and militias, and it was... If you were alive during that time, and I was, and although young, read the news, it was a bad situation. I mean, they evacuated, I think, something like 1,500, 1,600 Orthodox Jews in the Old City, went to West Jerusalem as a whole unit. They evacuated them out because of the violence. They were just getting in the Old City, they were just getting slaughtered. The Arab village of Lifta, which is today within the bounds of Jerusalem, this big, big Arab village, was captured by the Israelis, and its residents were loaded on trucks and taken to East Jerusalem. So they literally moved communities out of the way. Okay, this won't mean much to you, but the villages of Deir Yassin, En Karim and Malcha, which are villages around the outskirts of Jerusalem, as well as neighbours on the west side and the Jerusalem's old city, came under Israeli control, and their inhabitants were forcibly dispersed. Now, think about that and think about it today. There are people alive today who were part of that displacement. They certainly, their children and their grandchildren are. And all they've heard is how we were used to live here, and now we're over here, not doing so well. And, you know, you can see where the current conflicts arisen from. Okay? It's funny, there's an Israeli there's an Israeli historian called Benny Morris who documents, and he's got an opposite number called Waleed Khalidi. They documented the expulsions and the massacres that occurred with these expulsions on both sides. So nobody could say, oh, they did it, we all did it. As I said, there is no understanding of people when they feel like their back's up against the wall. The Jewish religion is, Judaism is a religion of peace, as is Christianity, as is Islam, come to think of it. But people do what they feel they have to do under pressure. Okay, 1947, of course, they proposed a plan for the partition of Palestine and for Jerusalem to be a city of international administration. It was completely surrounded by an Arab state at that time. Just a highway connected it to the Jewish part of it. And then, of course, in 1948, there was the war. Jerusalem was divided. The western half became the newly formed state of Israel. The eastern half was annexed by Jordan. So now we have a city divided down the middle. Jordan on one side, Islamic state. Israelis on the other, a Jewish state. Okay, And the big thing was that the old city of Jerusalem went into Jordan's hands. Now you can imagine how the Christians felt about that. Not only was the city divided, as it had been back in the Middle Ages, but it wasn't divided between Muslims and Christians, it was divided between Jews and Arabs. So where's the Christians? What about our holy places? You see where this is going, can't you? Okay. Jordan, not the current king, but his father, they reneged on a commitment to discuss free access to the Jews on holy sites, and you know, under its jurisdiction, including things like the Western Wall and the Jewish cemetery on the Mount of Olives. Remember all those, quote, old geezers, unquote, who'd come there in the 1800s to die and be buried on the Mount of Olives? Huge big cemetery there, okay? And that was provided in the ceasefire agreement, which was would come out to in 1949. Jordan permitted new roads in the cemetery, but then they used tombstones to provide for the roads. Not a big thing to do if you want to win friends and influence people. The cave of Shimon the Just, which was a place to visit, a holy place to visit, became a stable. Jordan, well, according to my research, they ransacked ancient synagogues, libraries, and centres of religious study. They destroyed 12 of them, totally. It was, you know, it's our faith, it's our city, and knock everything else. Which had happened back in at least twice, if not three times, in the centuries preceding this. So it wasn't exactly something new. Okay? I remember reading this. They went to the United Nations to, you know, complain about Jordan not following the rules and this sort of thing. And there was a big outcry to make Jerusalem an open city, you know, which makes perfectly good sense. Nobody runs it. It's an open city. Stop all the destruction. But as always, nothing happened. But I have to say this, similar to Jordan's treatments of the Jewish holy sites, numerous Muslim holy sites, mosques and cemeteries under Israeli rule in the West Side were defaced. So it's tit for tat, isn't it? Okay, some were destroyed as part of development projects, like the Jordanians. They built a park called Independence Park in the center of Jerusalem and literally destroyed a Muslim cemetery to do that. One justification, I read this somewhere, which commentator I read, said was offered for the increasing demolition of the mosques was to spare Arab people's sorrow because they were there and they couldn't get to it. Okay. Anyway, in 1950, Jerusalem was declared the capital of Israel, and it's also the largest city in the country. Now, during the 1967 war, which we're all fairly familiar with, East Jerusalem was captured by the Israelis. The what they called the Moroccan Quarter, with about, I don't know, 300 or 400 homes, was totally demolished, inhabitants expelled. A public plaza was built in its place, adjoining the Western Wall, the one you see in films today. That big public plaza in front of the Western Wall was, in fact, the Moroccan Quarter. Okay, but the Islamic Trust was granted administration of the Temple Mount. Jewish prayer on the site was prohibited by both sides, so it didn't cause any problems. Most Jews celebrated the event as the liberation of the city, and they formed a Jerusalem Day project. But it wasn't really, because there's still a whole bunch of Palestinians living there, as we know, in various places. Most of the large gatherings in the State of Israel take place in the Western Wall today, including, by the way, the swearing in of various army officer units. There in Masada, you probably remember that. Okay, and there's huge celebrations there on Independence Day. And of course, there are tens of thousands of visitors who visit on Jewish religious holidays and other tourists and this sort of thing. And the Western Wall has become a major tourist destination, because the bottom part of the Western Wall is the basis for the balustrade of the second or third temple. Remember we talked about that a few hours ago? It's that old. I mean, it's that important too, because part of the original temple of the time of Christ. You know, and really at the moment, except for the security situations that are now in place, most religions are granted access to the church's holy site. So in other words, the Arabs can go to the Temple Mount, the Jews can go to the Western Wall and that sort of thing, and the Christians go to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, and the Orthodox, and go to the whichever grave you want to. There's two grave sites for Christ in Jerusalem. Kind of interesting. You have to figure out which one's which. It's now changed in that they've stopped Arabs from going to the holy sites, which again is like a burr under the saddle. So the Palestinian West Bank, you know, this sort of thing, still all focuses around Jerusalem. So today, in 2016, Jerusalem is being squabbled over, fought over, discussed in countries all over the world, with people coming up with solutions for it and other solutions. There's bombs going off and terrorist attacks, as there was in the 1800s, as there was in the 1600s, as there was in the 1100s, and so forth. Jerusalem is constantly in a, except for between 800 and 900 to 1,000, except for that period there, most of the time Jerusalem has been in some form of upset, one or the other. It was in Christ's time, the Romans were there, okay? And let's be honest, the Jews in Christ's time were you would not have been able to tell them different from the Arab cultures around them other than their faith. It wasn't like they dressed differently and this sort of thing. They were all together there. And Jesus, when he was in Jerusalem, would have seen all the different mixes of races in there. Pentecost, how many people were there from other countries? Remember that? So it's amazing that this one city has been the focal point of three, sometimes four religions. Every religion claims it is their center. Every religion fights hard for it. And it's still in a state of flux. Perhaps another 100 and so years, it'll change again. But there it is. The major cities of the Bible, Jerusalem. Next week, Jericho. Read your Bible, read up about Jericho. There's a couple of good stories from there. Till then, good night. God bless.